as we conclude conversations surrounding the events from the EndSARS movement 1 year later, we're being joined by international relations expert Micheal, from Ghana, and of course, social entrepreneur Kofo Kego. Thank you very much, gentlemen, for joining us.
Thank you, Anne, and thanks for having me on the show.
Yes, Micheal, I have had a conversation with you about how the world perceives Nigeria's handling of this issue of, you know, EndSARS and young people protesting against police brutality and bad governance. Now, it's a year, exactly a year after people were killed, people were shot at, people were injured at the Lekki Toll Plaza in Lagos, Nigeria. And we saw people come out to commemorate the day. And if you have been following the news coming up from Nigeria, you would see almost a repeat of what happened. This time, even though people were not shot at or killed, there was some form of police harassment and malhandling. The main reason why that protest even happened in the first instance. I'd like to ask you what exactly you see looking from the outside in, and of course, how the police and government is dealing with this issue.
Well, first, to begin with, I must say that for those of us in Ghana and other parts of the continent, it came as a shock when we started seeing images and, more importantly, bloody videos of innocent protesters who were shot, some killed, during the Lekki Toll agitations. What even became more surprising to some of us was the faulty attempt by the Nigerian security services and the government in general to cover up the massacre. Initially, there were attempts to deny that people were even shot in the first place. There was an initial denial. Then later, it was accepted that, yes, people were shot, but no one was killed. But later on, we found out that people were actually killed. And another shocking aspect is that one major medium through which people started spreading the images and videos during the protest, which is Twitter, social media, was banned in Nigeria till date. And if you deny people the platform, the opportunity to pour out their anger, their frustrations, if you deny them the basic platform to do that, at the end of the day, the people will resort to violent agitations to demand for their rights. I believe that it would have served the Nigerian government better if it had allowed Twitter to operate in Nigeria so that daily the youth can vent their spleen, they can come out with their frustrations, the youth can have a platform to communicate and share their opinion on happenings within the country. When you deny the people all these opportunities, they may have nothing to do but to resort to violent agitations. Again, following the feed this afternoon from Ghana, I saw even the police arresting people into cars. I saw tear gas being fired to disperse the crowd. And I was asking myself, has the Nigerian government, has the Nigerian security forces learned anything from the Lekki Toll Roads? Quite strangely, 1 year after the massacre, no policeman, no military man has been named as responsible for the death of one of the protesters. Till date, the Nigerian government has not published any concluding findings with regards to happenings during the Lekki Toll raid. I know there was a fact-finding committee that was established to look into the whole brouhaha, but till date, we've not had any published finding. No police officer, no military man has been interdicted for the massacre that I think happened at the toll booth. And it is quite strange that the government will subject its very citizens to all these forms of cruel harassment, all in the name of demanding for better policing reforms. And I believe the onus lies with the Nigerian government to do the right thing currently.
Kofo, you're a Nigerian in diaspora. You're joining us from the UK, and we saw you and many other Nigerians protesting last year, in solidarity with Nigerians within Nigeria who seem to be feeling the pinch more than you. A lot of people were asking why Nigerians in diaspora were even bothered, knowing that, you know, some people would say they've survived, you know, and ran away from the kind of brutality that Nigerians are facing here, but that's an aside. why did you even in the first instance think that it was necessary to go on this protest? And here we are today, 1 year later, you're on TV talking about it. Do you think that they seem to be hearing us, or they just choose not to?
Okay, thank you so much for having me this evening, you see. I agree with most of the things that Micheal said, you see. I think as a diasporan, I'm a Nigerian wherever I find myself. If I go to the UK, if I go to America, if I go to Canada, I am a Nigerian. And they wouldn't treat me as an individual. They would treat me as a collective. I'll be treated as a Nigerian wherever I present my passport. Even if I present a British passport, my name says Kofo. And I am all Nigerian, you see. So when Nigerian becomes better, it works for every single person. Whether you are living in the UK or you're living in Nigeria, we all want to see a better Nigeria. We all want to come home and want to add to the economy of Nigeria. We all want to build the nation together. So if a brother of mine is suffering in the hands of the police, or a structure or a system is working against them, it is affecting me also. Because one of the things I teach is we need to go from this individualistic mentality to a communal mentality where we work as a group, as a people, as a collective. With the government, I don't think the government is hearing us. I don't think they are paying attention to us. I think they're thinking of the 2023 election. I think they think it's the same thing they've always done. They always do, you know, find a few young people, you know, give them money, give them Range Rover, give them scholarship in top universities, and think all is going to be over. But I think something has changed. And let me just ask this. See, I see a lot of people stop me on the road and say, oh, what did you achieve with EndSARS? What did you achieve with the movement? You guys just wasted your time, you wasted your money, you wasted your effort. I even had the same conversation with my barber today. And I said to him, I don't think we wasted our time, money, or effort, but I think something has changed. Something has broken. Nigerians are speaking about their nation. And the guys in diaspora have seen how a democracy should work. They've seen how a nation should
work. I'm sorry, Kofo, I want to come in there. Really, has something changed? If you were watching from the beginning, the Minister of Information, the person whose duty is to inform us, he's also supposedly a spokesperson for Mr. President, has come up to say that this whole thing that we're talking about is a phantom. So really, has anything changed?
You know, the dishonorable Minister of Misinformation, the Honorable Minister of Information, Lai Mohammed, I think his words are suspect. I think we need to pay attention to it. But we, the people, we know something has changed. The media or the information or the narrative can be passed out that says nothing has changed, you know. No, something has changed. People are speaking. Nigerians around the globe are speaking. The international community is listening. You know, the way you come to the UK, you come to America before and just walk on the street, Nigerians will stop you on the streets of London and question you as a Nigerian minister. It's not the same thing anymore. So something has changed. The one thing about change is a process, and process takes time, you see. But something has changed. People are waking up gradually.
Okay.
Gradually. And this is why we need to keep speaking and doing the things we're doing.
Well, unfortunately, we're out of time, gentlemen, but thank you so much. What a way to end this conversation. Micheal Nketiah is an international PR expert, I beg your pardon. He's a political, international relations and political analyst. He's joining us from Ghana. And Kofo Kego is a social entrepreneur, and he joined us from the United Kingdom. Thank you very much, gentlemen. We have to go now.
Thank you.
All right. I want to thank you all for staying with us. It's been a very great conversation, a marathon. When we return from this quick break, I'll give you my take. Here's my take. Now, I must say that I'm ashamed and utterly disappointed that this nation that you call ours, you and I call our own, has come to this. I mean, this is supposed to be a land of freedom, peace, and unity. We used to sing it when we were in primary school, but that seems to have faded away. Nigeria is now a country where our troops, who should be protecting us and our borders, have turned their guns on us, killed, maimed, and even done this with reckless abandon. But what is our crime, you would ask? Well, we ask for good governance. We ask that, you know, a group of policemen stop being profiling us wrongly because we have iPhones and we have laptops. You know, we ask for an end to police brutality. We ask that the police authorities stop killing innocent Nigerians through their rogue police department called SARS. But instead, they hung us on a cross. They decided to oppress us and harm us, forgetting that they also aren't left out of this oppression. You see, that's the irony of things. We're all on the receiving end of this bad leadership. Whether you are in uniform or not, whether you carry a gun or a pen or a flag, we all are the victims here. Now, until the police and all Nigerians realize that we need to band together to rid this nation of these corrupt and irresponsible politicians, we will continue to wallow in poverty and pain and even more grief. But I'll end this by saying, we haven't forgotten. We will never forget. The blood of the slain is crying out for justice, and justice they will get. So I'll say, let's end SARS, let's end bad governance, and make Nigeria great again. I am Mary Anacol. Have a good evening.